Good morning, student friends. In today's session, we are going to discuss about one of the popular applications of the op-amp, and this is called as the peak detectors. The learning outcomes of this session include, after completing this session, student will able to describe working of peak detector circuit, and then they can comment about the components selection for the components which are used in designing peak detector circuits. The content include, we are going to discuss about in general what is a peak detector, then we will discuss about positive peak detector, and lastly we'll have a look at what are the requirements for the component selection of designing the peak detector. As the name suggests, peak detector is a circuit for which I am applying a AC signal or a sinusoidal signal or any other signal, and the output of this is a DC signal which always represent the peak value of the signal. So in this diagram, as you can see, the signal is varying, then this is the peak value, so the output is, it remained at this value, then for the, then the input goes down but the output remains constant, and when again the input rises to a new peak value, the output again attains that peak value and remains constant. So even though the input is going low, the output remains constant, so the output always represents the peak value of the input signal. There can be two types of the peak detectors. One is a positive peak detector, which always detects the positive of the input signal, positive peak of the input signal, and the other one is a negative peak detector, which detects, or rather the output of which is the negative peak value of the input signal. This is a simple circuit which represents or which describes the positive peak detector circuit. The circuit is designed using, of course, operational amplifier and few components. As you can see, there is a operational amplifier 741 is used. The output and then the component, output component include, there is one diode which is placed in the feedback path of the op-amp, diode D1. Then there is one more diode D2, and of course there is a capacitor. Now if you know, dear students, a peak detector, passive peak detector, can also be designed using simply a diode, a load resistance and a capacitor. However, the passive peak detector design may suffer with what is called as the loading effect, and to avoid the loading effect, we can see that the using the similar component, that is nothing but the load resistance, then the capacitor and the diode, we have designed a peak detector. But in this case, as operational amplifier is being used, it is going to avoid the loading effect. Let us have some more details about this circuit. As you can see, the op-amp requires two type of the power supply. Plus VCC is of 15 volt, minus VEE is of minus 15 volt. Then this represents the load resistance. The capacitor is being used, which is actually detecting the peak voltage. Then interestingly, you can see there is a resistance ROM. Now this resistance ROM, as we know, is used for the compensation of the input bias current. So in total, this is a circuit which is acting as a peak detector. Now how this work? Okay, in order to analyze the working of this circuit, we need to consider operational, for this circuit, we have to consider the input sinusoidal signal. Instead of sinusoidal signal, I have considered a square wave signal over here. So as we know, there are two half cycles, a positive half cycle and a negative half cycle. So what happened during the positive half cycle and what happened during the negative half cycle, we need to analyze. Let us first understand what happened during the positive half cycle. Okay, so during the positive half cycle, as you can see, when the input is positive, as you can see, then the output of the op-amp is going to be positive. When the output of the op-amp is positive, which makes the diode D1 on. When the diode D1 is on, the feedback loop is completed and op-amp simply work as a non-inverting voltage follower. So whatever the Vin is applied over here, it appears at this point. Now when it is appearing at this point, it also makes the capacitor charge. So as you can see, the capacitor start charging, and the capacitor charges to the maximum. Very rapidly, the capacitor charges to the maximum value, and that voltage will appear over here. So as you can see, for this positive half cycle, the output is nothing but the voltage across the capacitor, which is nothing but the peak voltage of the input signal. During negative half cycle, now when the input goes negative, the output of this becomes negative. Now when output of this op amp becomes negative, the diode D1 is no longer on, it becomes open circuit, and then the loop is not completed, and the output of the op amp will go into the saturation. However, what is the voltage which is delivered to the load resistance? The voltage which is delivered to load resistance is nothing but the voltage across the capacitor, and then this voltage remain constant, and that is being delivered across the load resistance. So we have seen that during positive half cycle, the capacitor get charged to the peak value, and during negative half cycle. Now during negative half cycle, one may think that why only the capacitor will try to deliver the voltage across the load resistance. However, there may be two more paths for the voltage across the capacitor. One, of course, the path is to the diode, but as during the negative half cycle, diode is open circuit, the voltage will not reach. The second path is, of course, the path through the operational amplifier. But as we know, the input impedance of the operational amplifier or input resistance of the operational amplifier is very high, and that's why the only path for the capacitor is to appear across the load resistance. So if we now look at the waveform across the load resistance, it almost remains constant, and that is nothing but the peak value of the input voltage. So this is how, when the input is a square wave or a sinusoidal wave, the output voltage across the load resistance remain almost constant. I will not say it is constant, but it is almost constant, and it is equal to the peak voltage of the positive waveform. As you can see, the output is representing the positive peak voltage. This is called as the positive peak detector. Now, dear student, please pause the video and answer this question: how to design a negative peak detector? Okay, so I think you are ready with the answer. See, there are two diodes. There is a diode D1 and there is a diode D2. The negative peak detector can be designed by just replacing the polarities or reversing the polarities of the diode D1 and D2. So instead of this anode and cathode, if I connect cathode at this point and anode at this point, and this diode is also inverted, then that will become a negative peak detector. By the way, in this positive peak detector, what is the purpose of this diode D2 is, during negative half cycle, when the output is negative, this diode becomes on, and which makes the when whatever the output saturation voltage for that, this diode will act as a path. So that is about the positive peak detector. Now, as we have used a capacitor and we have used a resistor and there is a load resistance, we have to comment or we have to talk about what are the different types of the component that can be used and how these component can be selected. For a complete and quick charging of a capacitor, the RC time constant associated with capacitor must be less than the time period of the input waveform. As we can see, we are applying a sinusoidal or a square wave input to the circuit, and then there is a, with every capacitor, as we know, there is a RC time constant. Now, in this circuit, what is that RC time constant? So now during the charging, as we know, the capacitor charges through the diode becomes on, and that the resistance of the forward bias diodes is nothing but the R in this equation. So we can say that the C, that is the capacitance of the capacitor multiplied by RD, the CRD must be less than the time period. So for to be on the safer side, we are just trying to see that this equation is satisfied. The CRD is less than or equal to T by 10. So by making this T by 10, we are ensuring that the RC time constant is much lesser than the time period of the waveform. And as we know, the C is nothing but the capacitor, and RD is the resistance of the forward bias diode, and that is equal to, usually, typically, it is equal to 100 ohm. So this is about how the components are governed during the charging. Now during the discharging, we can say that for the capacitor not to discharge, RC time constant associated with the capacitor must be greater than time period of the input signal. Now this condition can be satisfied. So if we can achieve C into RL. Now during when the capacitor is trying to discharge, the capacitor is discharging, the discharge for the capacitor is through the load resistance, and then we can say that C into RL, if we want that the capacitor should retain its charge for sufficient amount of time, then the CRL must be greater than T. And the T to be on the safer side, we can say that CRL must be greater than equal to 10T. So this ensures that the peak voltage is retained. So in this case, the C is the capacitor and the discharge path is to the load resistance. So RL in this case, instead of for R, we are using RL. Now this may raise one more question, is that we are saying that we should have CRL should be greater than or equal to 10T. But please remember, the RL is a load resistance on which we may not have a control. So if the value of RL is not sufficiently high, then the peak voltage may not be retained. How to solve this problem? This problem can be solved by connecting one more op-amp circuit, which is called as a non-inverting voltage follower, between the capacitor and load resistance. So there will not be any gain offered by the operational amplifier, but in this case it will act as a buffer, and then it can solve this problem. Lastly, we can say that a popular op-amp 741 can be used for usual operations, but if input frequency, the signal frequency is very high, then we need to use high speed precision op-amp operational amplifiers like 771 or 714. So lastly, we'll come to the discussion, and I would like student you to have a discussion about what is going to be effect. We have seen that there are two equations which need to be satisfied, which are related to RC time constant. What happen if those equations are not satisfied? How the waveform is going to change if those equations are not satisfied? So that is what I'm leaving for you discussion. The reference used for the today's session include Operational Amplifier and Linear Integrated Circuit by Ramakant Gaikwad and Linear Integrated Circuit by Roy Chowdhury and Jain. Thank you, student, for a patient listening.